Good morning, everybody. Welcome to our morning outdoor worship service. Thank you all for joining us. Thank you for those that are watching on Facebook Live. We're glad you could be with us this day. It's such an awesome time of year that we are celebrating the oncoming, the advent of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. So, beautiful time of year. This coming Wednesday, Thursday night at Christmas Eve, we should have, weather permitting, a Christmas Eve service here outside at 7 p.m. So we'll let you know by 5 o'clock through Facebook Live and also on our website whether or not we're going to have a worship service for Christmas Eve. It may be stormy, so then we'll, pastorally, I'm sure, we'll do something inside the building for Christmas Eve regardless, but we may not have it here outdoors. So keep looking on Facebook Live for a message from us. Also, this coming Saturday at 9 a.m. will be our food pantry. So if you or someone you know needs food, please send them here. We'll be here at 9 o'clock, here to serve outdoors, a drive-through methodology. And we have food that we want to just get to into people's hands on the 26th, that Saturday, 9 a.m. And New Year's Eve, we will have a 7 p.m. Facebook Live worship service. We'll get the year started off, hopefully for all of you, and say goodbye to 2020. Sound like a good idea? This is one of those years you're really glad to see go. But needless to say, God has been in the midst of it all. We give God praise and thanks that we're able to be here today and worship God. We thank God for all the people that have continued to be here for us, to make donations even online and so on and so forth, to keep the church operating, and ministries are still ongoing, so we're glad we could do that as well. So we're going to start here this morning with prayer. Let us go to our God. Loving God, in the name of Jesus, we come before you. We thank you, God, for this time and this place that we come here this day to worship you, God, to thank you, God, for sending your son Jesus so that we could be saved, so that we could have a relationship with you, God, so we can grow and change and become like you, Lord. We thank you for that now. I ask a blessing upon everyone who's here this day, those that are watching, God. May they feel your spirit. May they have their heart and soul and mind uplifted, God, and may they receive, above all, your love this day. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. Merry Christmas, Christ's Cornerstonians. Are you guys all ready out there? And I'm not talking about your Christmas list. I'm talking about this. Is your heart ready for Jesus? As we celebrate his birth on Friday. Welcome to the week of love. We're about to start our week of love. So this week you'll be hearing a lot of messages because, boy, I tell you what, that is the thing that Jesus brought to us, wasn't it? Unconditional love and forgiveness. He loves you so much, and I hope that this week you understand that fully. Let's get started with some Christmas songs. I only have a couple more weeks of Christmas songs, so here we go. Let me hear you this morning. Nice, good intro. All right, that was the intro. Here we go.
Come to Bethlehem, we're going to go into our time of Advent now. So we are in week 4 now of our Advent season. David was 30 years old when he became king of Israel, and he reigned for 40 years. Now, David wasn't perfect, but he put his trust in God, and he served him well. And God blessed King David, and Israel flourished during his reign. After God had given him success against his enemies, a palace was built for this great king of Israel. And when the palace was finished, and David was settled in his new home, he called for Nathan the prophet, and he said,
"It is not right that I am living in a palace of cedar, while the house of God remains a tent."
David wanted to build a temple for God to take the place of the tent that had served as God's home for many years. That night, God came to Nathan with a word for David. God would have a temple as David wanted, but it would not be built by David. But that wasn't all that God wanted David to hear that night. God wanted David to hear these words.
"This is what the Lord Almighty says. I took you from the pasture and from following the flock to be ruler over my people Israel. I have been with you wherever you have gone, and I have cut off all your enemies from before you. Now I will make your name great, and I will provide a place for my people Israel, and I will plant them so that they can have a home of their own. The Lord declares to you that the Lord himself will establish a house for you. When your days are over and you rest with your fathers, I will raise up your offspring to succeed you. I will establish his kingdom. He is the one who will build a house for me, and I will establish the throne of his kingdom forever." Imagine, becoming human was not a twist of fate or a punishment from a higher being. It was a choice. God chose to give up everything to become nothing.
God made a covenant of love with David that day, a covenant in which God promised never to take his love away from David or from his offspring. The line of David would remain on the throne of Israel forever. You see, the king of David would come, the king of all kings. This king would save God's people, not just for a time, but forever. God's love is so much more than our own, and we celebrate that today as we remember how he sent his son, a king in heaven, to earth to be with us. What love.
We will now light the fourth candle of Advent, the candle of love.
So it's now our opportunity to show our love by our tithes and our offerings this morning. And the scripture for the offering comes from Luke chapter 3. It is when John the Baptist was proclaiming the good news of Jesus Christ and helping people to turn from who they were to become followers of God and to change and be changed by God through baptism. And it says in verse 8, "Prove by the way you live that you have really turned from your sins and turned to God." The crowd asked, "What should we do?" John replied, "If you have 2 shirts, give one to the poor. If you have food, share it with those who are hungry." That's how we prove that we are God's children, by sharing of our food, of our clothing, of our time, of our prayers, and of our tithes and our offerings. So as you give this morning, you're showing that you have been changed by God, and you're in turn, because of the love that's within you that you received from Christ when you received him, you can't help but love others by giving a part of who you are and a part of what you have. So as you give this morning, we have 2 offerings. One, of course, is for the church and its various ministries. The second is for our community outreach, which is our food pantry. So we take the word of God literally. For those of us that have more than enough, we're always ready to share and give to others, because that's how we show people love. Let us pray. Loving God, we thank you. We thank you that you provide for all of our needs, and especially you provide love inside of each and every one of us that each of us can have. But that love is meant to be shared, God, so we thank you for that. We give you now our tithes, our offerings. We give to people in need, God, especially through our food pantry. And we give to the various ministries of this church so that we can spread the good news of your love for everyone through everything this church does. In Jesus' name, amen.
Lord, we're so happy to be able to be here together to worship you, to praise your name. And we're so thankful that you are here with us, giving us your support and your strength and your guidance. And we have these prayers here for you today. We have prayers for individuals in rehab facilities and hospitals and nursing homes. Please be with them. Prayers for Laura and Jeff and their business. Prayers for those who are sick or are dealing with health issues. Specifically for Courtney. We pray, Lord, that she does not have COVID. And for Kaylani, who is dealing with COVID now. We have prayers to uphold the following individuals: Frank and his health and recovery, Lori and Laura. We ask you to provide wisdom and energy to Don and I as we're in our challenging endeavor of owning a new business. We have prayers for Pam and the loss of her spouse. Please be with her, Lord. We have a praise report for Sam being healed. Thank you, Lord. We lift up a friend who is starting over again, Lord. You know the specifics of that situation. We just lift her up, take her into your hands, Lord. We ask for provisions and peace of mind for Elizabeth. Prayers for Jane and the loss of her spouse. Prayers for traveling mercies for Catherine. Prayers for Ambrose, Cindy's dad. We pray that you will heal him, Lord, that you'll make his heart stronger after the stents have been put in. We have prayers to rid a body of mold so that he can absorb food and water again. Just pray for health in that individual, Lord. We feel such peace, Lord, knowing that you are with us and that you've heard these prayers today, and not just the prayers that I've spoken, but all of the unspoken prayers and the prayers in our hearts. We thank you for your love. In Jesus' name we pray.
Wipes away all tears. There's a presence that changes atmospheres. There's a name. We will fix our eyes on the one who overcame. We will stand in awe of the one who forever.
think now. Oh, so sorry. Oh, well, okay. Whatever I just said was awesome. And I'm going to say it again. Oh, this has been the year for our church of love. We began the year 20 years ago, it feels right now, but in early January, the theme for our church this year was let us do everything in love. So I think we've been able to do that as hard as it seems and how the resistance has been and sometimes the obstacles have been, but we always know that love is the thing that lasts forevermore. It endures forever. And so it's with great guidance and direction this morning through the Holy Spirit that we can come back full circle to realize when Jesus came to earth, he was the great hope that people were wanting for redemption and to feel unconditional love and forgiveness. They were needing to be able to have a sense of joy and certainly peace of mind and heart. And how that all came, I believe I've talked to you before about how all of those things are sisters and brothers of each other, essentially of faith and all the other things wrapped up in that. But the greatest thing that God brought to us through Jesus Christ is love. Unconditional love was born on the day he was born to this earth, and then on the day that he died for all of us, every last person on the planet, that Jesus ended his life, leaving us love, unconditional love of forgiveness and eternal life as a result. So everything he did from the coming from a space and a purpose of love. That's all he came here to do, is to love other people and to show God's love. Because people sometimes don't always know how to love, do they? And some people can't love at all or feel love sometimes. And so God saw fit to send his son Jesus so that we would know what love is. So love visited the earth when Jesus was born, and love stayed upon the earth through the power of the Holy Spirit in God's people. So love lives on through you and through me. So love will never end. It endures forever. But how it's actually shown is by the way we treat each other. Because as we know in the book of John, the last thing that Jesus gave as a commandment to his disciples who are going to follow up from him is love one another. And if you love each other, people will know that you're my disciples. And so we continue in that same theme, that same purpose. We know that love changes people, love heals people, love is the thing that people need this Christmas and every other day in between all the time. And love is what causes each and every one of us to do what we do, because love is a verb, it's action. And so we see that in Jesus all the time and through the power of his Spirit. And there's a particular story I love that Jesus was so popular. People followed him everywhere. Why? Because he was a man of love. He exuded it. Everything he said, everything he did, all the healings and miracles he performed were based on his act of love for people. He just loves people so much. He had joy over them, and he wanted them to have peace of heart and mind and to be a part of him, to be connected. He wanted to be in relationship with people. And everywhere Jesus went, there was always a crowd. Always a crowd. Of course, why? And why is there still a crowd today, I believe, of people that are seeking God? It's because all of us still need love, don't we? All of us do. And at the same time, we're here on this planet, those of us that are here, we're here to be Jesus's disciples, of people of love who show love all the time. Not just by our words, but by our actions, always. Beautiful. So in Luke chapter 19, it says, Jesus entered Jericho and made his way through the town. There was a man there named Zacchaeus. He was one of the most influential Jews in the Roman tax collecting business, and he had become very rich. He tried to get a look at Jesus as he was traveling with that crowd through Jericho. But he was too short to see over the crowds, plural, huge crowds, huge crowds. So Zacchaeus was too short to get a look at Jesus. So he ran ahead and climbed a sycamore tree beside the road. Sycamore tree is a fig tree, by the way. So he could watch from there. He was going to just watch Jesus pass by. He wanted to get a look at this man that so many people had talked about, so many people were healed from, so many people had said, he knew everything about me, and yet he loves me anyway. I was lost, and now I'm found. I was blind, and now I can see. I was lame, and I can walk. I was alone, and he brought me love. And so Zacchaeus just wanted to get a look at this guy. What does love look like? So there he was, and he climbed the sycamore tree to just get a glimpse of what love is. Maybe, just maybe, if he could see love go by, he could realize it really does exist. Because remember, Zacchaeus is a tax collector, hated by the Romans and the Jews, because he also was a notorious sinner, cheating people out of their money. And so he was somebody that wasn't really in the in crowd at all. In fact, he was somebody that if people had seen him, they would say, get the heck out of here, Zacchaeus. What are you doing here? He would have been judged harshly. He would have been rejected. He would have been condemned. And so it shows in Scripture that he knew he couldn't be in the crowd, but he had to get a look at this Jesus. He had heard so much about him. And maybe in his heart, he really wanted to change. And he thought, maybe love would change me. Nothing else has. Money hasn't done it. He was very rich, but he was poor in his heart and in his spirit. We can have all the possessions of all the world, but if you lose your soul or don't have your soul, money never replaces love, ever. We can use money to show love, right? That's what it's used for. It's a transaction we make. It's an exchange where we show love by giving to others so that they can understand what love is, especially if they're in need. But Zacchaeus was a broken man. He was somebody who did not understand love at all. And maybe he never was loved. So he tried to fill his life with this money. So he did whatever was necessary to get that money, to try to fill an empty hole that was inside of him. So he climbs a sycamore tree and he wants to just get a look at Jesus. Verse 5, when Jesus came by, he looked up at Zacchaeus and called him by name. Zacchaeus, he said, quick, come down. I must be a guest in your home today. Just imagine, right? Zacchaeus is up at the tree by himself and he hears his name and he sees this love go by and that love calls his very name and says, come down quick, come be with me. I'm coming to your house today. What would the crowd be thinking in the midst of all that? Jesus stops short. He's walking, all the people are following him, and all those people just stop short with him, I'm sure, trying to get closer to this Jesus, this man of love. And he stops and he talks to Zacchaeus. And Zacchaeus is up in this tree and he went, oh, you talking to me? Yeah, Zacchaeus, come on. Come on, I'm going to be a guest in your house today. Zacchaeus quickly climbed down and took Jesus to his house in great excitement and joy. Just imagine, you're trying to get a look at love. You're trying to see who this Jesus is. And this very Jesus stops in the midst of all these thousands of people and looks at Zacchaeus and says, I'm coming to your house. Do you see how each one individual, every last one of us, matter to God? Do you see that? Do you understand that today? Do we have any Zacchaeuses in the crowd that want to know what love is? Maybe never knew it. Try to find it in other places. Jesus wants to come to your house today. He's coming there. Quick, climb down from the place where you were, or climb up out of the hole you've been in. Get up out of there and take Jesus home. Take him into your heart. He'll never leave again. He builds a home in here. This is where the temple of God is. Inside of each and every one of you and me, no matter who we are, even if we're a notorious tax collector, or any other kind of whatever we call ourselves or people label us to be. Jesus calls us by name and says, quick, I'm coming to your house today. Invite him in. Well, he's knocking, right? I got a funny feeling about this Jesus. If Zacchaeus didn't climb down, Jesus is climbing up there. I know Jesus has climbed into my life more than once, especially in the deepest, darkest moments. When you think you're alone and at your last wit's end in the darkest of the night, suddenly you hear the Spirit of God. God's love comes and visits you all the time. He never leaves you alone. So Zacchaeus climbed down and took Jesus to his house in great excitement and joy. See, we Christians were supposed to be filled with what? Joy. Joy and excitement. The Savior of the world, who was born 2,000 some years ago, is born in you. Wow, aren't you privileged and honored? But the crowds were displeased. He is going to be the guest of a notorious sinner, they grumbled. And what do you think Jesus did? Ignored them. Stop listening to those voices. They don't matter. Meanwhile, Zacchaeus stood there. He stood there. He's face to face with Jesus now, right? The crowds are grumbling, blah, 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 whatever they're saying. And here's one-on-one with Jesus and Zacchaeus. And he stands there and he says, I will give half of my wealth to the poor. And if I've overcharged people on their taxes, if I have? Oh, and I sort of have. Well, since I've overcharged people on their taxes, I will give them back four times as much. Which comes, by the way, from the Old Testament. When you cheated someone, you were supposed to give back four times over. So some of us got four times things coming back to us, too. Keep that in mind. Jesus responded, salvation has come to this home today. He's now in his home. He made it to the home. What home are we talking about? Right here, not a physical place necessarily, but in the heart. Salvation has come to this home today. This man has shown himself to be a son of Abraham. And I, the Son of Man, have come to seek and save, to seek and save those like him who are lost. Lost in the sense of not understanding what love is, not understanding that they could be forgiven, that they think they have to keep God at a distance because they're unworthy or undeserving. Those people who are lost in that respect, Jesus came to save and seek them and save them and seek them and seek them and seek them and seek them. And we're here to seek people and save them and help them understand that God's unconditional love is for everybody. Anybody, all people, everywhere, throughout the entire world, everyone who thinks that they can't be loved by God especially, Jesus Christ came for that very purpose, to seek them out, even if they're hiding up top of a sycamore tree or down in the cellar or in the places where some of us have been seeking things that never satisfy. Trying to fill the hole by other things. That's where Jesus goes and seeks us all out. If it's many of us told our testimonies, many people are not found necessarily in a church, but they're found where they are. And then hopefully they make their way to a church where there's love expressed, the love of Jesus Christ, the acceptance of all people. And are any of us in this room out here, any of us a little bit like Zacchaeus, perhaps, or have been that way in some way, shape, or form. Imperfect, for example. Anybody? Nobody? Oh, the people on Facebook are like, whoa, yeah, me. Comment. Yes. He came to seek you. He wants you. He wants to come home to be with you. Wouldn't it be cool if you could have Jesus as your guest in your home? Just like for Christmas, right? Of course. Oh, and Easter too. We'll invite them then. Oh, no. How about every single day when you wake up, you realize Jesus lives in you. Love lives in you. You never are ever, ever, ever going to be without love. Now, for those people that are without love, what are we here to do? Seek, that's right, show them that love. Seek and save them and say, okay, you're a little scruffy here. You got a little rough edges around you. You're kind of a porcupine personality. However, Jesus wants to come and live in you, loves you. And hopefully what happened to Zacchaeus happens to all of us. When salvation comes upon us and we realize, wow, God forgives me for all I've ever done wrong. God loves me despite myself. God wants me to be in relationship with him. That feeling is a feeling of excitement and joy. And then we change internally. Then we want to live for God, don't we? We want others to receive what we receive, don't we? Of course we do. See, what Jesus was actually doing in chapter 19 was actually is something he taught in Luke 14. See, Jesus wants to be a guest in everyone's heart, everyone's home. And in Luke 14, they have this big meal for him, and he goes, and all the people are gathered around this great big banquet. And Jesus is sitting there, and he's looking around at all the people, and some people want to sit in a place of honor. And I don't know about you, but if Jesus showed up at my house and you all were there, or if Jesus shows up here, I'm going to, like, nudge my way to get closer to him. You know my personality, right? Oh, so, but no, you go first. No, you go first, right? But in Luke chapter 14, he says to the host, when you put on a luncheon or a dinner, don't invite your friends, brothers, relatives, and rich neighbors, for they will repay you by inviting you back. Instead, see, we Christians, we have to do a lot of instead. We don't live the way other people live. We live the way Jesus is teaching through these scriptures here. We're here to love all the Zacchaeuses we ever come across. We're here to give them God's love. But we're also here to do what Jesus says in this very chapter of Luke 14. And in this verse, he says, instead, verse 13, invite the poor, the crippled, the lame, and the blind. Then, at the resurrection of the godly, God will reward you for you inviting those who could never repay you. See, love is only shown by us giving something to somebody else, expecting what? Nothing in return. Have you ever loved people so much and poured yourself into them and they give you nothing back? Lack of reciprocation? I hope so. Because that's what Jesus often did. Or if you love people that were imperfect, anybody love me? Say yes. Okay. I have to clue you in on something. As godly as I am, I'm imperfect. I know. It's a shock. I know. If you hang around me long enough, you'll be able to find and point out all those imperfections. But we're here to love each other unconditionally the way Jesus does, right? We're here to, by our love to others and overlooking their faults and overlooking the things that we find wrong, instead of being grumblers like the crowd and wanting to judge others, we invite them in to God's home, into relationship with God. So I don't know about you, how very often we love to have Jesus as our guest. Wouldn't it be cool on Christmas Eve, really, once you go to sleep and, you know, you're waiting for Santa to show up? But the problem with Santa is you better watch out, you better not pout, you better not cry, I'm going to get you. What an awful song as a child. Santa Claus is coming to town. Oh, my gosh. please don't come to my house. But when Jesus comes and is your guest, right? Different feeling, isn't it? Isn't it? Wouldn't it be cool if Jesus showed up at your house on Christmas Day? What would you serve him? Think about it. Now, I don't know if he's going to, because where does Jesus already live? In your heart. So guess who's going to show up on Christmas morning at your house? Yeah, just put an empty chair there. I know he loves blueberry pancakes especially. So very often, many of us want to, you know, in all the years I've been pastoring, so many people want to see God. They say, I don't know if there's a God. I don't know if I feel God. I don't know, hear God. The way you talk about God, Pastor Joyce, I don't know what you're talking about. I just want God to come like and come get on me some way. I want some experience. I want God to prove he exists. And as I sit there listening, I'm thinking, are you looking at me? Are you not seeing God? Is there something going on with me that I'm not showing you God's love? Because guess where people get to see and know God? Through us. So the scriptures this morning describe to me what Jesus is all about in a nutshell, if you will. It's all about showing love to the unlovable, the unworthy, the undeserving, and especially the imperfect. And he wants to seek and save the lost. Not that he's going to come back. Eventually, when he comes back, he's still going to be seeking, by the way. In Revelation, he says that. Going to still knock on people's doors. But needless to say, while we're waiting for him to come back, how are people going to know God's love? Through you, through me. When we show God's love to others, whoever they may be, that's when Jesus and you are a guest in somebody else's home and in their life. So this morning I have a special poem that someone is going to read who happens to be blind. So I think she memorized it. Candy, just so you know, about 16, 17 years ago, she was given about 6 months to live. The doctors, when I was here at the church, well, actually it was back in 2005. I was here at the church, and she came to say goodbye to me because the doctors had told her to get her affairs in order and say her goodbyes. And she came to actually have her memorial service prepared with me. And God said to me, no, that's not her time yet. So I said to her, well, come on with me into the sanctuary. We're going to pray instead. Hey, you're still here. So, you know, we talk about Christmas miracles. This is a, I don't know when miracle happened, but we moved here in, I guess it was June of 2005. So this is a June miracle right here. And over the last couple of years, she's had 5 or 6 strokes. She has 6. Who's counting? And she's lost her eyesight. But she hasn't lost the love of God. She hasn't lost a sense of purpose to touch the lives of others. So I was visiting with her the other day at her house. We were doing, I don't know, I was doing whatever I do. And talking probably. Anyway, and she said, have you ever heard the Christmas poem by Helen Steiner Rice? And both of us, oddly enough, were English majors. And so I was like, oh, yeah, I remember her. She used to have cards. You got them at Hallmark, wherever, you know. Oh, yeah, great poet. She said, well, have you ever heard this Christmas poem? And I said, no. Well, let me hear it. Well, let's hear it. And so she said it to me. And I could feel the power of God so strongly then, I said to her, would you mind having that poem given to the church, given to our congregation, given to those watching, so that they could be affected and touched and receive a great gift this morning? So here she is.
happened to be my grandmother's favorite Christmas song, and so mine. And I couldn't wait to hear it every year. So it would take me back to those Christmases of yesteryear with my grandparents. Except this year. I mean, with everything being so screwed up and terrible, just coming off of Thanksgiving, and let's face it, it's terrible. We couldn't travel, we couldn't gather and fellowship, and now we're rolling into Christmas. It's not any better. There was no phone lines on Black Friday, no busy shoppers, no Christmas parties,
Christmas parades, or Christmas festivities. But God being God, one day I was just working around my house, kind of in a funk with my head in the sand, thinking, our holidays are ruined. Christmas is ruined. And this song came on my Pandora. And God gently reminded me, you can't ruin Christmas. Christmas is in our hearts. The first gift ever given at Christmas was a baby in a manger, bringing us hope, peace, joy, and love everlasting. So I'm a little excited and extremely honored to share with you today my Christmas guest by Helen Steiner Rice. It happened one day near December's end, two neighbors called on an old friend. They found his shop so meager and lean, made gay with 1,000 bows of green. And Conrad was sitting with face ashine when he suddenly stopped as he stitched a twine and said, old friends, at dawn today, when the cock was crowing the night away, the Lord appeared in a dream to me and said, I'm coming your guest to be. Well, I've been busy with feet astir and strewing my shop with branches of fern. The table is spread and the kettle is shine, and over the rafters, the holly is twine. So I will wait for my Lord to appear and listen closely so I will hear his step as he nears my humble place and I open the door and look on his face. So his friends went home and left Conrad alone, for this was the happiest day he had known. For long since his family had passed away, and Conrad had spent many a sad Christmas day. But he knew, with the Lord as his Christmas guest, this Christmas would be the dearest and best. So he listened with only joy in his heart, and with every sound he would rise with a start to look for the Lord to be at his door, like the vision he'd had a few hours before. So he ran to the window after hearing a sound, but all he could see on the snow-covered ground was a shaggy old beggar whose shoes were torn and all of his clothes were ragged and worn. But Conrad was touched, so he went to the door and he said, you know, your feet must be frozen and sore. I have some shoes in my shop for you and a coat that will keep you warmer too. So with grateful heart, the man went away. But Conrad noticed the time of day and wondered what made the Lord so late and how much longer he'd have to wait. When he heard a knock, he ran to the door, but it was only a stranger once more, a bent old lady with a shawl black, with a bundle of kindling piled on her back. She asked for only a place to rest, but that was reserved for Conrad's great guest. But her voice seemed to plead, don't send me away. Let me rest for a while on Christmas Day. So Conrad brewed her a steaming cup, told her to sit at the table and sup. But after she left, he was filled with dismay, for he knew that the hours were slipping away, and the Lord hadn't come as he said he would, and Conrad felt sure he'd misunderstood. When out of the silence he heard a cry, please help me and tell me where am I? So again he opened his friendly door and stood disappointed as twice before, for it was only a child who'd wandered away and was lost from her family on Christmas Day. Again, Conrad's heart was heavy and sad, but he knew he should make the little girl glad. So he called her in and wiped her tears and quieted all her childish fears, and then led her back to her home once more. But as he entered his own darkened door, he knew that the Lord was not coming today, for the hours of Christmas had passed away. So he went to his room and knelt down to pray and said, "Lord, why did you delay? What kept you from coming to call on me? For I wanted so much your face to see." When soft in the silence, a voice he heard, "Lift up your head, for I kept my word. 3 times my shadow crossed your floor, and 3 times I came to your lonely door. For I was the beggar with bruised cold feet, and I was the woman you gave something to eat, and I was the child on the homeless street. 3 times I knocked, and 3 times I came in, and each time I found the warmth of a friend. Of all the gifts, love is the best, and I was honored to be your Christmas guest." Thank you.
So this Christmas as we are waiting for our Lord to show up in our lives, as Jesus spoke in Matthew 25, "As you did it for the least of these, you are doing it for me." And so Jesus wants to be your guest, but more importantly, he wants you to make sure other people are the guests at your table, whatever that table is. So as we leave today, let it be all of the things that Advent means that we have inside of us, but most of all, let it be God's love that we share with everyone this coming Christmas and for all the rest of all the days of all of our lives. Amen? Amen. Let us pray. God, we thank you for your great gift of unconditional love for everyone, God, including all of us. We thank you, God, that you've also entrusted us with your people, that whoever you put in our path, God, who needs love, you'll show them to us, God. And may we always be on the lookout to seek and save those people, God, who need love most of all. And may we, God, continue in this Christmas season and for all of our lives to let love live in us, so that other people can come to know you as their personal friend, Lord, and Savior. And we thank you, God, for coming into all of our hearts and all of our lives. Be our guest, and may we welcome every guest that you put into all of our lives. May we share your love with each and every one of them. In Jesus' name, amen. God bless you all. We love you. Continue to show God's love to everyone. We'll see you tonight at 7 o'clock for a hymn and a prayer, and hopefully we'll see you Christmas Eve. We love you all, and share God's love wherever you are.